I now want to ask you the really challenging question over here. And it goes as follows. One of the weaknesses of SLAM is, as we move along and map a world by seeing these landmarks, the matrix omega, which is the big thing here, and of course the vector xi, grow linearly with the length of the path. Now this means if you go to your local supermarket and buy a robot, and that robot lives for a long time, say a year or a decade, then this thing here, the path, will be really, really large, even though the environment in which it might operate, the map, might be of a fixed size. And that means a robot programmed by GraphSLAM will eventually stop working because it gets slower and slower. Now, we all know computer operating systems that have that property. The older they are, the slower they are. But I'm not talking about how to fix operating systems, I'm just talking about how to fix SLAM. So the crucial idea that I want to tell you about and I want you to implement from scratch in our software is the following. We can actually reduce the map we maintain to one that only contains the most recent position in the path. And all of the stuff over here can be safely erased when we build our map. So you don't know how to do it, but let me tell you. Suppose we have a robot position and we have a matrix omega that only contains the information pertaining to one position. If the position is one-dimensional, it's just one row and one column, whereas we might have many different entries for the map. So suppose the robot moves to a new position. Let's call it xt plus 1. Then we do exactly the following. We grow the matrix and the vector by using the expand function that you're already familiar with, such that we now have space for our new position. The new area we added are these rows over here. It's a single row of numbers of our position is one-dimensional. It's two rows of number of our position is two-dimensional. And it's this column that, again, is just a single column if our position is one-dimensional. Otherwise, it's two column. And we initialize those all by zero. And then we can apply our regular motion update that, as you know, adds one or some number like one to the main diagonal and minus ones off diagonal. And the same on the right side for the vector xi. That is a legitimate motion update, but that runs the risk that our path increases. So now we go back to a form like this. We make xt plus 1 survive. Simplified speaking, you might think about doing this by just cutting out the new submatrix that starts over here and the subvector that starts over here. However, if you do this, as you can easily verify, that submatrix doesn't give you the correct answer. And here's where the meat is. We now cut out three submatrices or values from the full matrix on the right side. One sits here, that one I will call A. One is over here. It's a single element for a 1D robot, but it's a 2x2 matrix for a robot in 2D coordinates. And one that I call C. And it's obvious to see that this thing over here that we're about to cut out is called A minus 1. These values carry a lot of importance. We can't just erase them. But we can fold them back into the surviving matrix by the following simple operation. We take the surviving matrix to be called omega prime and the surviving vector to go x prime. And you can get omega prime and x prime by using the function take that is in your matrix library. You have to look into how to make take exactly those elements over here. And then we modify x prime and c prime with the following piece of math. We subtract from omega prime a transpose times b to the minus 1, the inverse, times a. If you implement this correctly, this gives you a matrix of the same size as sigma prime, and that's what you subtract to arrive at our reduced sigma. Similarly, you do the same for xi. You subtract a prime minus b to the minus 1 times c. This turns out to be the same as a Gaussian where we technically do away, or we call it integrate away, the variable x1. And I don't want to go into detail whether that's correct. My book has a multi-page proof of that simple equation. I just want to give you an intuition here, which is these values do carry importance. And to get rid of those, you have to redistribute them into the remaining variables. And that over here happens to be the math. So it's A transpose times B times A that you subtract from the remaining omega prime. And the same for C over here. When you do this, You are now left with a matrix of the same original dimension, because we first added a pose and then we subtracted one. And as you can see, when you do this many, many times, the final dimension of the matrix is only determined based on the size of the map, plus, well, a single entry, which in the 1D case is one row and one column, in the 2D case is two of those, corresponding to the robot position. That means SLAM scales to really large environments, because we can do the trick every single time a robot moves. So you ask for a challenging programming assignment. I promise you, you'll be busy with it for a while. I'm giving you now my piece of code in which I implemented SLAM for you. You're familiar with this. You have all of that. And when I run SLAM with three landmarks, three time steps, a world size of 100, and a measurement range of 100, I make data at random, as you're familiar with, and I compute the result, and the result in this case contains a vector of omega, xi, and mu concatenated, then what I might get out looks as follows. There's three landmarks. There's a sequence of estimated positions leading up to the actual robot position. They're about correct. And then there's estimates for where the landmarks are. Every time I run it, I get a different answer because my landmarks and my world is different at every time. Now, I also implemented, and that's your task now, a function called online SLAM. It does exactly what I told you to do. It resizes the matrix every time a new motion occurs and then goes back to the original size. And I've printed out here as an example the information matrix omega and the vector xi that I obtained, and also printed out the final result. In the final result, we get exactly the same estimated pose as for the full SLAM algorithm, which is 86.0 and 33.7. So we'll go down. These are exactly the same number for the estimated pose. That's how you can verify this. The same is true for the estimated landmark. Those coordinates are identical, despite the fact that I reduce the size of omega and xi. But when I print omega and xi, we'll find that the dimensionality is reduced. It's an 8x8 matrix omega, and the number 8 comes because there's 6 coordinates for the landmarks and one final robot pose. That is substantially smaller than the matrix I would obtain for the full SLAM case. And the same is true for the information vector of size 8. Here's an example. So what you are asked to do is to fill the entire online SLAM routine. And to do this, every time you get a new pose, you run expand to grow the matrix by inserting something right behind the existing pose. You then run take to take out the submatrix. You also calculate A, B, and for the information vector C. And then as before, your reduced omega is obtained with this equation, and your reduced C is obtained with this equation. If you make no mistake, then you get exactly the same values as you have before, and we can test your routine in arbitrary maps and arbitrary data sets, and it'll just be fine. So good luck. This is a wonderful programming assignment because it gives you the first really scalable SLAM algorithm. And when you implement it, it's actually a major achievement. I can tell you it took the scientific field of SLAM easily 15 years to really discover this form. And ever since, what was really complex and involved lots of Kármán filters, and I can tell you lots of headaches, became amazingly easy. So implement it, and you can call yourself a robotic mapper.